Last year, I released my first indie game on Steam, Xbox, PlayStation, and Switch. It won awards, it got 96% positive reviews, and it made enough money that this is now what I do for a living. I'm really proud of that. Making that game changed my life. But I have one major regret. I just wish it didn't take me 35 years to finally do it. So, welcome to my TED Talk, where I tell you exactly what I would do if I wanted to learn to make games from scratch and didn't want to spend 35 years doing it. Let's start with a bit of strategy. So everyone learns differently, but for me, the best way to learn is to learn by doing the thing. So in this case, that means making games, not just doing tutorials. They're a bit of a trap. So our strategy will be to learn how to learn how to make games. Now, I didn't misspeak there. We are going to learn how to make games. I'm being a bit pedantic, but the idea that you can learn to make games implies that there's an end state, and once you've learned it, you're done learning and know how to make games. But that's not really how it works, like, at all. Making games, especially solo or as a small team, means taking on a dozen full-time disciplines that other people spend their entire lives learning, like art, music, programming, writing, marketing, game design, business, and on and on. You can't simply learn all those things. So instead, learning how to make games means we're adopting a lifetime practice of continuous learning. We need to get comfortable not knowing things and build up trust within ourselves that when we hit a roadblock, we'll know how to learn our way out of it. To do that, to learn how to make games, we want to always be moving forward towards a very specific goal. And when we get to a part where we don't know what to do, then we'll find a tutorial or an article that teaches us the key ingredient we're missing to achieve that very specific objective and get back to work. Concrete goals, like a very specific game you're trying to make, will help keep you motivated and stay on track. Remember, the goal is to make a game, and that will inform what we need to learn to unlock the skills to make the thing. So we need to decide on a game that we're going to make. Now everyone says to start small, and they're absolutely right, but here's how we're actually going to do that. Pick a basic game that already exists, and I do mean basic, something between Brick Breaker and Solitaire. It doesn't really matter, but don't jump into creating your own game just yet. Now I know, there are a million tutorials telling you to remake Flappy Bird, and you just want to get on with making your own game, but just trust me, my approach is going to be a little bit different. There's a ton to learn about making games, from code to music to art, and it can be overwhelming. What I'm proposing is that we want to learn as we go, to avoid getting overwhelmed. Recreating an existing game keeps our scope in check, gives us a very concrete goal to work towards, and most importantly, it also prevents us from needing to learn game design at the same time. Honestly, game design is much more difficult than making games, at least for me. And actually, this is going to be a running theme, so strap in. Making games is kind of the easiest part of making games. You'll know what I mean soon. So rather than adding game design to the long list of things that we need to learn, let's just get started learning how to use our engine, get ourselves nice and comfortable with our tools, and then we'll learn game design. Deal? Right. Speaking of engines, chances are we're going to want to start by picking a game engine. Now, you've almost certainly heard of game engines before, even if you don't exactly know what they actually are. Essentially, an engine is a set of tools and frameworks that let you build games without reinventing the wheels. They'll typically give you the ability to add rendering, physics, audio input, and all that kind of stuff to your game with pretty minimal setup. An engine isn't strictly necessary, and look, I love the idea of creating my own engine as much as the next programmer, but when you're just starting out, trying to build your own engine is a trap. You don't know how to make games yet. How are you going to build a framework for making games? I spent the first few years of my game dev career writing my own C++ and OpenGL tooling, barely achieving anything that you would actually consider to be a decent game or engine, before switching to Cocos 2DX and eventually Unity back in 2014. You can do whatever you want, but trust me, an engine is just going to let you get on with things much quicker. As for which engine to choose, well, it doesn't matter. Experience with a single engine is far more valuable than any shiny new tools that another engine can offer you, so don't overthink this step. Let's just get on with gaining some experience. Unity, Godot, Unreal, these are the best publicly available general-purpose game engines that have ever existed. You're spoiled for choice. You really can't go wrong. Of course, they all have their strengths and weaknesses, but they're also all more than capable. If one jumps out as the most interesting to you, then go with it. Otherwise, spend 1 week doing the official intro tutorials for each, and by the end of the week, you have to choose one. Just pick one. I can't tell you how much people overthink this. I like Unity. You can use Unreal or Godot. It doesn't really matter right now. You get 1 week. Choose. Now, there's one more thing that we can't quite ignore, which is programming. Obviously, I'm biased here because I come from a software engineering background, but I genuinely believe that coding is the closest we have to a game dev superpower. From systems to tech art, you can really stretch your game's imagination with some programming knowledge. You get a lot of bang for your buck. However, The basics are really quite basic. There are two ways we can go about it, traditional code or visual scripting. As much as it really pains me to say this, again, I'm a software developer through and through and I absolutely love writing code, I have to admit, visual scripting is perfectly adequate and plenty of games don't write any actual text-based code anymore. In fact, if you picked Unreal as your engine of choice, their visual blueprint system is specifically designed to make coding accessible to non-programmers. And Unity has their own visual scripting system. I can't say I've ever used it, but I do know that plenty of games have been made with it very successfully. Now, chances are you have some idea of what goes into making art or music, but if you've never programmed before, there's a bit to learn. So with your engine of choice, I want you to take a little bit of time to do some intro programming tutorials for your engine. These are the only kind of general tutorials we're going to do, but I don't want you to get stuck in tutorial hell. You're not trying to become a senior programmer here. Just take a few days to make sure you know how to reference objects in your engine, how to move objects around, get a kind of general feel for how the update loop works. This is actually a good exercise whether you know how to code already or not. Coding is really at the core of making games, and it can really free your creativity to run wild and create really interesting systems. So we don't want to be afraid of writing a bit of code. Still, we do always want to be moving forward towards our goal, so don't spend too long here. Just get comfortable enough so that when an article tells you to create a function or define a variable, you know what they're talking about. Whew. Okay, getting a bit hot in here. Okay, so you've got some basic comfort with your engine, you know some very basic programming, like how to move an object around the screen. Let's get cracking. Take the game you're remaking and try to break it down into small, digestible components. If we're talking about Brick Breaker, we have 2D images that represent objects, a paddle controlled by player input, a ball that bounces off of objects, bricks that are destroyed when they're hit by a ball, a sound effect that plays each time the ball bounces, and so on. Breaking your game down or your feature down into digestible little elements gives us a task list to implement. Breaking down large features or tasks into the smallest components is a really great way to stay focused and continue making forward progress. You'd be shocked how motivating crossing items off a to-do list can be, whether it's day one of making games or day 10,000. It's also a really useful exercise for planning ahead, and as you gain experience, you'll get better and better at breaking down features into their component elements, designing your implementation and approaching it in a logical order to optimize development time. You really want to get into the habit of doing this. Let's not get ahead of ourselves though. For now, just pick the first item on your to-do list and let's get to work until it's crossed off. As you start, each item on the list is almost certainly going to require learning something new to accomplish it. Don't know how to create 2D images and bring them into your engine? Find a tutorial and get it done. Don't know how to receive keyboard input? Find a tutorial and get it done. Don't know how to bounce a ball? You guessed it, find a tutorial and get it done. And I'm talking a week or two, a month tops, by the way. Don't spend 6 months recreating Brick Breaker. Brick Breaker is not the goal. Learning how to learn is the goal. And that's why we're not just finding a Brick Breaker tutorial. It won't teach you how to make games in your engine. It'll just teach you how to make Brick Breaker. And at the end, chances are, you're not going to know what to do next. It's a really easy trap to fall into, but focusing on breaking our target game down into its component elements and implementing each of them one by one, solving challenges as they come up, is the way to make games. Honestly, buckle in. This is game development. You're doing it. Over the course of years, you'll spend less time searching for articles and tutorials as you build your foundation of knowledge. But if game development were a game, this would be the core loop. Design a feature, break it down into its component elements, tackle them one by one, researching as needed, and then playtest, which we'll talk about later, and then repeat. If you want to make games, get comfortable in this cycle because you're going to be doing it for years to come. Okay, once you've recreated your Brick Breaker, spend one or two more days polishing it. Make it juicy, make it punchy, make it fun. Polishing a game is also much harder than making a game. Improve the art, add some sound effects, add some particles. We're not going to release this, so don't go too far with it, but have some fun. My secret goal here, the reason for this exercise, is to push you to stay in this flow of working on a game, getting to a point where you don't know what to do, and then instead of giving up, you learn how to learn. You learn how to solve problems, and then you get back to work. Half of game development is solving problems, so we really want to get comfortable being in this space. Polishing an existing game still keeps us bound to the scope of the original game design, so we don't have to deal with the problem of having a blank canvas, but we can start to get a little bit of a feel for what it's like to be unbound and branch out on our own while still learning some cool effects. Spend a few days on this, have some fun. Hopefully at this point you're spending a little bit less time thinking about the how. The tools should be getting a little bit more familiar to you, and perhaps you're spending less time searching for tutorials. When you do go into tutorials, really try to focus on the why. Why does it work this way? Why is the author telling me to do these things? Why is this the way that I need to do it? The quicker you solve the why, the quicker you move past the how, and you can finally focus more on what you want to make. When you feel you're ready, when your tools are starting to feel a little bit more comfortable and familiar, it's time to move on. Now, don't close your remake project just yet, though. There's one more thing to do before we start on our own game. I want you to spend a few more days adding your twist on the game that you remade. This is your chance to get a feel for some game design. Come up with some novel twist on the game you remade, and see if you can implement it, and even more so, see if you can make it fun. I'm willing to bet that you're going to find this the most challenging part of the process so far. That word fun is really going to start feeling slippery. What feels fun to you might not be fun to someone else, and sometimes something that sounds fun in your head ends up being boring or completely broken in practice. So now we can get into the real flow of game design. We're going to theorize, implement, playtest, evaluate, iterate. If you decide that a new power-up is the way to improve Brick Breaker, don't stop when it's working. Play it. Does it make the game easier, harder, or just plain annoying? Try tweaking it. Instead of making your paddle bigger, maybe it shoots a second ball. Maybe the bricks move. Maybe the paddle slowly shrinks as you play. Have fun with it. This is game development. The point isn't to make the perfect version of Brick Breaker right now. It's just to get used to this process of trying something, testing it, learning from it, and trying again. And here is the most important thing to understand about game design. Sometimes your ideas suck. They'll fail. That's the job, though. In fact, most design experiments probably won't make the game better, but the only way to discover the good ones is to try them. And hopefully, over time, you get more of an intuition of what's going to work. Playtesting is the most valuable thing you can do when you're making a game. So you want to get to playtesting as quickly as possible. And the earlier you learn that and get into the swing of playtesting, the better. Trust me. And by the way, playtesting isn't you playing the game, that's a given. It's giving it to other people, preferably people who don't know you, but for now a friend or sibling will do just fine. Watch them play without telling them what to do. What confuses them? Where do they get bored? Do they smile when your shiny new power-up triggers? That's the most honest game design feedback you'll ever get. Honestly, an hour spent playtesting will teach you more about game development than 100 hours working on your game in engine. Add something interesting, test it, tweak it, maybe throw it out, and then try another. That's game design in a nutshell, and the earlier you get comfortable with that cycle, the better. Once you've done this for a few days and you have a taste for how fun and how hard game design really is, you're finally ready. Now we have a bit of a sense of what goes into making a basic game, so let's go a little bit bigger. It's time to make our own game. Something with a small scope, something you think you can finish in a month or two, because in reality it'll almost certainly take at least twice as long. Here your goal is to learn how to make your games and how to finish games. Finishing games is also a lot harder than making games. So you'll need some sort of plan for the scope, which is the kind of entire contents of the game. I make narrative games, so I like to start with a beat sheet, and recently I've even started writing a screenplay format to map out the content of my game. But for most games, you probably want to start with something that looks a bit like a game design document. Something like that. It doesn't have to be terribly formal, don't stress this, but make sure you scope it out and make sure you understand the boundaries of the game. Then figure out where your gaps are. What do you not know how to do? You want to be aware of your gaps, but don't stress it yet. You don't need to learn all those things today. In fact, trying to learn them all today is just going to overwhelm you and you'll probably quit. Just be aware, and once you have your game idea in your scope document, it's time to get to work. You're going to learn by doing, just like you did with your Brick Breaker project, learning things only once you need them. Start building your game, and when you get to a part where you need to add a dialogue system and you don't know how to do it, you go find a tutorial for that specific requirement. Then you keep on moving, keep making your game. When you get to the part where you need 3D audio and you don't know how to do that, do a tutorial. Then keep making your game. Always remember your goal is to make a game, not to do tutorials. With this foundation of breaking larger games and features into their component elements, taking them one at a time and learning as you go, you're honestly unstoppable. Over time, you will find yourself doing less and less tutorials as you gain more knowledge and you build your skills. At this point, after you've finished and released your first real game, I want you to shift your mindset a little bit. At this point, I want you to start actively looking for interesting tutorials and video essays on new and more advanced concepts. This will spark a lot of creativity, it'll keep you excited about making games, and it'll help keep you up to date with the new tools and techniques. Game development is far too large of a subject for any one person to learn everything. It's ever-changing, and we haven't even talked about the marketing and business side. Over time, you're going to look back on your old code and features, and you're going to think that they're the most sloppy, primitive, crap things you've ever seen. And that's great. It just shows how much you're growing. Game development is a never-ending endeavor in learning, but that's not something to stress about, that's really the joy of it. Learn how to learn, and you'll never be stopped from making progress. I sincerely hope that this was helpful for you. I know we glossed over a lot of topics here, but I truly believe that learning how to learn is not only the best way to do it, it's actually all you need to start your game dev journey. Many thanks to all my patrons, and a special thank you to my magpies and my ospreys, Elegon, Jason Hansen, Ellie Swaley, Justice Lind, Brandon Pung, Peter James, Sigil Games, Will Todd, Mags, Neil Blakey Milner, Peter Randall, Alex Dev, and Alex Zed. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.